Radio DePaul is proud to bring you the DePaul Writer Series. Featuring professional authors and student writers discussing their written works. And now, the DePaul Writer Series on Radio DePaul.
Who am I then?
I am the Him, the Absolute Being. Understand that I am not merely one being among other beings. I am the being, the being of all beings. Those are the words of Jonathan Barrows, the central character in the novel Watch Out by Joseph Sulia. And what a coincidence that I am joined here in the studio by Dr. Joseph Sulia. How are you?
I'm very well, Derek. It's a pleasure to be here. Thank you for having me.
Yeah, well, it's great to have you. First of all, I'm happy that I got a hold of you. You've had some health problems recently.
It's true.
You were in the hospital for how long?
48 days.
Which is a pretty good excuse, I think, just to avoid my emails for that, for 48 days. But
I'm glad you understand. Emails tend to demand an instant response, and sometimes feelings get hurt. I'm glad that yours weren't abraded in any way. But no, I was confined for 48 days. I won't talk about the cause, but I was extremely ill. But I'm recovering. I can't say with any degree of honesty that I am completely recovered at the moment, but I'm slowly moving toward recovery.
Well, that's great to hear. So we will talk significantly about Watch Out, but I do want to start with you published two books before
this is
Watch
true.
Out.
This is true. Yes.
The first one that I was able to track down was the work of literary criticism.
Yes.
Correct?
Yes. That is a version of my dissertation. It's not exactly my dissertation. It's a book about self-sacrifice, in particular, the motif of self-sacrifice in 18th century German literature, but also in 20th century literary criticism, and how just basically, it's about mortality and the idea of making of one's mortality a project, and how this appears in certain literary works of art and works of philosophy. It's a very difficult technical book. I recommend it only to people who are deeply, deeply interested in philosophy and literary criticism and philosophy. But my other book was called Years of Rage, and it's something of a catastrophe, and I kind of look back on it and wince because there are some very inane passages. It was my first novel, and so it's deeply problematic, but there are also passages in that book that I love. I've decided once I'm finished with my two current projects that I'm going to return to Years of Rage and rewrite it, because I can't just leave it like that.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I want to revise the inane passages. I want to expand it considerably. Some of the passages are inelegantly written, and it's hard for me to leave a sentence inelegantly written.
Now, is that something that you, a conclusion that you came to recently about the book, or is that something that you've always felt from the time of its publication?
You know, it's remarkable because I've actually felt this way about the book since the very day that it was accepted for publication. And the press, which is a small press, not a vanity press, but a small press that decided to publish it, they were actually reluctant to publish the book. It was originally accepted by a huge press. I can't tell you the name, but it was a huge press. They rescinded. At one point, GQ wanted to interview me about the book. Then they revoked their offer. The book is just a disaster as far as its publication history and the history of its reception is concerned. But I would say it's a silent disaster because the book was just surrounded with a contemptuous silence. Very few people read it. Very few people reviewed it. But strangely enough, I have to say it has a small but dedicated cult following. Yeah. I don't know why.
Yeah, that's interesting. Could you explain a little bit about what the book is about? It's based on the Columbine High School.
That's the historical framework. It's based on the Littleton Massacre of April 20th, 1999, known as the Columbine High Massacre. And this was before school shootings became routine. Mm-hmm. I mean, these days you hear about a school shooting. I mean, I'm exaggerating slightly, but almost every other week. But that was the historical framework. But really, I wanted to, really, the novel was based on a feeling that I both had and wanted to communicate. And I just had to communicate. Mm-hmm. It was just like I could not communicate it. And that was the feeling of one human figure surrounded by kind of subhuman objects. And these subhuman objects are endlessly attacking, violating that central human subject. And so that's really what I that's really the feeling that I wanted to communicate in literary prose. And also I had a number of images in my head. And I simply used the Columbine High Massacre as a backdrop. And at the end of the day, anyone who really knows the details and knows about Klebold and Harris knows that really there are so many divergences between what I've written and the actual account of what happened on that gruesome day.
Right.
That it's really not a Columbine book at all.
Yeah.
And there's a huge body of literature that emerged from that massacre. Joyce Carol Oates has written about it. Dennis Cooper has written about it. Countless people whose names I forget have written about it. You had many opportunistic writers who wanted to hop on the bandwagon. I wasn't one of them, though. I wrote actually much later than they did. The book wasn't published until 2005. They scribbled out their opportunistic Columbine books.
Right.
The day after the massacre hit, because they wanted to be relevant and they wanted to sell copies. I wrote the book because I felt I had no other choice. And actually, I did have in mind a novel that was set in a high school for a long time, because it seems to me that the high school was the perfect environment for the novel. High schools are really enclosed spaces, and they're very much like prisons because attendance is mandatory and no one wants to be there.
Right.
That includes the faculty and the staff and the janitor and everyone else, the principal, mm-hmm. the vice principal. Anyway, I digress.
And high schools can also be very hostile places or very friendly places, depending on what your perspective is, which I think is fertile ground for any kind of literary argument.
Yes. And in this case, I chose a pariah. I chose an outsider, someone no one likes. The narrator, who is nameless, I deliberately made him nameless, is hated even by his own father, is hated by the girl he loves, is hated by everyone. And that's really what I wanted to convey.
Yeah.
I wanted to convey, again, a human subject surrounded by subhuman objects, and these subhuman objects are constantly bullying, harassing, violating this one human subject.
Right.
That will not change in the definitive version, which I will write probably in 2 years.
Yeah. So you mentioned that the novel came about due to a particular feeling that you had.
Yes.
Is that how you find that you normally work?
Yeah, it actually is. Let me explain. This is going to sound somewhat mystical, and believe me, I'm not a mystic, but I'm just going to speak honestly about this. I begin with images, and the images surface in my consciousness. I don't know where they come from. Oh, then again, I do. I mean, they emerge from my imagination. They issue from the unconscious mind, and they're siphoned onto the page. But of course, it's not a direct transmission. You can never directly write what emerges in your imagination, what comes from your unconscious mind. But let me say that I just begin with images, and I have no idea what they mean. Then I have words and phrases. I have no idea how they'll connect to the story. I have no idea what they mean either, but I just have words and phrases. This is random generation, and I know that. Maybe that's why at a very early age, really inappropriately early age, I was drawn to the work of William S. Burroughs, because actually William S. Burroughs would do that too. The same thing with the musician we're talking about, music, Captain Beefheart. You know him?
No, I don't know.
Great, great musician. Basically, they talked about turning themselves inside out. So what I was doing originally in the first stage, this is only the first stage, was externalizing basing my dreams. Sometimes they were based on dreams. Sometimes they were based on daydreams, fantasies, feelings I had. And again, I had no idea what they meant. But what happened afterwards, and this was why I only started seriously writing literature. Actually, this is why I only wrote literature after I completed graduate school, after I earned my doctorate. The second stage is extremely important. I didn't want to write haphazard prose poetry. I didn't want to do that. The second stage is when I intellectualize the images. I formalize them. So really, there's nothing random in Watch Out. It's true that you can't completely, or Years of Rage, you can't completely rationally explain every image, it's true, but there is a concatenation of imagery throughout those novels, and it does make sense. Sometimes people think it doesn't make sense, but I could explain every word of this book. And when I actually do explain what every sentence means and what every word means, then one understands. This is not originally it's randomly generated,
right?
But then I make sense out of it, and I find I don't want to use the word theme. Maybe motif would be a better word. Mm-hmm. But there's a philosophical concept usually that links together all of the imagery, which admittedly originally was unconscious.
Right.
Let me just say briefly, and then we can move on. There's the German philosopher Schelling. I've read a lot of German philosophy, pages and pages.
And it comes through.
Does it really?
Yes.
That's actually good, because right. That sets me apart from other writers. I think, I in all modesty, well, it's not like a virtue necessarily, but in all seriousness, I don't know of any other American writer who draws on German philosophy as much as I do, or at least in the way that I do. I don't know of a single one. Perhaps they exist, but I don't know of them.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know how many Americans are really taught philosophy. It's not typically a subject that is taught in high schools, really at any point before at least undergraduate college, and generally more graduate and postgraduate college, I think.
Everything you've said is true, and philosophy departments are closing throughout the country. But let me get back to Schelling.
Right.
Schelling has a wonderful definition of art in a book he wrote in 1800 called The System of Transcendental Idealism. He says that art is the making conscious of the unconscious. Mm-hmm. And that formula, not that it's a formula for me, but that statement summarizes my writing process. So just briefly, originally I have unconsciously generated images. Then what I do is I formalize the text, intellectualize the text so that it all makes sense, so that you could actually talk about it in a meaningful way.
Right.
It's not just like a dream transcription or something. And it's not me just externalizing my dreams. If I did that, then I would still be on the level of William Burroughs, mm-hmm. who I do admire, but I think at some stage you've got to get beyond that.
Right. It's not stream of consciousness. It's very formulated.
Yeah. I'm not fishing for compliments, but did you notice that?
I did notice it. It seemed like there was a very, I've read Watch Out. I did not read Years of Rage.
You're not missing much. Don't worry.
Well, I plan on reading it at some point, but it might not be until the definitive version comes out in a few years. But through Watch Out, I think it's apparent that there is a definite philosophical vein that runs from page one to the end of the book.
That's great.
It seems very unified, and there's not just one. There's multiple that you can extract.
Yes, I'm glad that you noticed that. I really am, because I wouldn't want anyone to think that this is just arbitrary. The book is not arbitrarily written.
Right. And it doesn't come across that way, at least when I read it.
That's good.
So that's a pretty good segue, I think, into Watch Out. Now, you mentioned that your process begins with images. Do you remember what images prompted Watch Out?
I remember once I was in a public place and a woman grabbed my jacket. I mean, I was wearing the jacket.
Mm-hmm.
She wasn't trying to steal it. She was just grabbing my jacket, and I was trying to get up. I know it was a strange, inexplicable moment.
Right.
But that night, I went home. I didn't want to be in that place anymore, and I started to write Watch Out. So it was a feeling that I think I had, actually, and that but also, again, a feeling that I wanted to communicate. Not of a human subject who is universally reviled, not of a human subject who's universally hated, but of a human subject who's universally desired. And I think many of us have had this feeling. You're surrounded by people who want to be around you, but you don't want to be around them. These are people who yearn for your attention, who yearn for your recognition, but you don't necessarily want to grant them your recognition. So this is a feeling I did have. Now, I have to be careful with what I say, because I have nothing in common with Jonathan Barrows. As a matter of fact, I disagree with him on almost every page. There are some things he says that I agree with. But in the case of Years of Rage and Watch Out, these are not autobiographical books. Both characters are masks that I wore. Mm-hmm. I think literature is never autobiographical. And unfortunately, much American fiction is just that. It's disguised or displaced autobiography, and I hold much of it in contempt. And if you've ever read my criticism, you know how much I hate much of American fiction, and I don't disguise it. But literature is not just fiction.
Right.
Literature is when you really annihilate yourself. So it's like Shakespeare. Shakespeare was not Iago. Nor was he Juliet. Isn't it interesting mm-hmm. how we have this gender thing going
yeah.
on? Oh, the author has to be the, you know. No, so I never was Jonathan Barrows. I never identified with him. But he was a mask that I wore, in the same way that I wore the mask of the narrator of Years of Rage. Let me say something, though, and this is not to be dismissive, because I have no problem with talking about Watch Out or any of my books. But I've actually, in a way, it's kind of ancient history to me.
Mm-hmm.
Because when you're talking to an author about a book that he wrote or she wrote 9 years ago, I wrote this 9 years ago,
right.
it really is ancient history. I still remember it, and I love talking about it, but I've moved on to a new kind of literature. I will never again write a book like this that's centered around a human figure. I've lost interest in that. I'll never again. I mean, it's true I'm going to revise Years of Rage, but that's just taking something that's already been written and renovating it.
Yeah.
But I've moved on to a new kind of literature. I'm working on a massive project now. It's taking me a long time to complete. I've worked on it for 8 years, but it's nearing completion. I don't want to babble. So
right. Well, why don't we? I want to come back to something
yes.
that you said in,
yes.
in a second. But before we do that, why don't we attempt to summarize Watch Out for those listeners who have not yet read it?
I'll try to be as diplomatic as possible. Watch Out is a novel that often reads like a prose poem. It's very poetically written, and it concerns a human being, a prospective college professor named Jonathan Barrows. Now, Jonathan Barrows is either the world's only completely self-contained human being, self-sufficient human being. He loves no one but himself, but you have to take that literally. He literally is in love with himself. He has no desire for any other human being or for anything else. Now, I'm not trying to say that he's selfish, because he's far beyond that, but that he actually sees himself as another person and is in love with that other person. So he's kind of like he's male and female at the same time. It could be the case that he actually is the things that he says he is, or he's completely delusional. I leave that up to the reader to decide. That
yeah.
he could be completely delusional. He's not completely self-contained. He could be an unreliable narrator. But again, I don't want to destroy the mystery of the book. But that's essentially what it is. Now, there one more layer, though. In the novel, and I have to say this, in the novel as it unfolds, Jonathan Barrows desires no one other than himself. And therefore, he is desired absolutely by others. It occurred to me that even though this might sound like a non sequitur, and perhaps it is, that was a really good premise for a novel. You have a central character who desires himself. He has fallen in love with himself, and he fakes love with himself. But therefore, he is loved, adored, worshipped, desired by others absolutely. So I think if I were to summarize the book, that would be how I would do it.
Yeah, and I think that that's a pretty good summary. Unfortunately, we need to take a quick break, so
oh.
we will be back in about 2 or 3 minutes right here on Radio DePaul, Chicago's College Connection.
All aboard! Hi, this is Ozzy Osbourne. For many years, you know I've had a drink problem, and I'm trying to battle that problem every single day. But one thing I don't do, I don't drive my car when I'm drinking. I get someone to drive me. Do not drink and drive. It's the stupidest thing. If you drink, just don't drive. Not only are you going to hurt yourself, you may hurt some other person, and you wouldn't want that on your conscience, would you?
A public service announcement brought to you by the U.S. Department of Transportation, RAD, the National Association of Broadcasters, and the Ad Council.
And then I brought her in a red mango last week to try it out, and now she won't shut up about it. She wants to go there every day. I should be getting really annoyed with her by now, except the yogurt is so good.
And the berries, and then we can put like a layer.
With their wide variety of all-natural frozen yogurt, over 55 toppings to choose from, your red mango options are endless.
You can put on top too.
So stop by the Lincoln Park Red Mango at 844 West Armitage, just east of the Armitage Brown Line Station. It probably won't be your last visit.
And then maybe we'll have...
There's nothing like Chicago staples. Deep dish pizza, the Crosstown Classic, and my favorite, sandwiches. Costello's has been serving Chicago since 1997. With locations in four Chicago neighborhoods, wide delivery zones, and ordering online, there's no reason not to indulge. Come to Costello's for sandwiches, fresh salads, and hot and cold sides, including their famous Chipotle mac and cheese. And did I mention their two new stores near DePaul at 2235 North Lincoln and in Wrigleyville at 3349 North Sheffield? So come on into Costello's for a classic taste of Chicago.
For the latest campus news you need to know and the entertainment reviews you can't live without, pick up this week's edition of The DePaulia. The DePaulia is the award-winning newspaper produced by your classmates here at DePaul. The paper covers everything from news to sports, features to op-eds. Did you miss this week's edition? Head over to thedepauliaonline.com to catch up on breaking news stories. And if you needed any more convincing, The DePaulia was ranked as the second most read student newspaper in the nation last fall. Want to write for the DePaulia, but you're a business major? No problem. Writing and editing positions are open to all students, not just journalism majors. Copies are available in various locations across the Lincoln Park and Loop campuses, including the SAC, Library, and Student Center. Don't miss a beat with DePaul's award-winning student newspaper, the DePaulia.
This message brought to you by Radio DePaul, Chicago's college connection.
This year, DePaul University's PLUS program and the Office for Students with Disabilities joined forces to create one department, the Center for Students with Disabilities. The newly created center now offers consistent policies, a fully staffed Loop office, and much more valuable assistance. To learn more about this new initiative, visit the CSD office in the Lincoln Park Student Center or call 773-325-1677.
This message brought to you by Radio DePaul, Chicago's college connection.
We're back on the DePaul Writers Series. I'm joined by Dr. Joseph Sulia, the author of Watch Out. And one of the things that we talked about before the break, you mentioned that you didn't relate to Jonathan Barrows. And I was at first surprised to hear you say that, just because the novel is told from such an intense first-person perspective. And it reads as such an internalized worldview into this character of Jonathan Barrows. And we've outlined a passage that I think summarizes this and is a great example very well. So if you wouldn't mind.
Not at all. Let me say, I think the reason why some might think that Jonathan Barrows' worldview is my own is because, well, this might sound arrogant, but it's because I write so well. I write so well that I'm able to convince readers. I'm able to write so vividly and intimately that it seems as if everything that I'm writing must come from a living subjectivity of some kind. But this passage here is one with which I certainly disagree. I also want to say that it's derived from the work of the 19th century German philosopher Max Stirner. And let me just say that in an English way. Max Stirner, who wrote a book called, I think it's translated as The Ego and Its Own. Mm-hmm. Das Ich und sein Eigentum in German for our German listeners, if there are any. And Karl Marx immortalized Stirner. Let me just say that briefly because that's important. Do you know we really wouldn't even know who Stirner was were it not for Marx? Because Marx I'm not even exaggerating, wrote about 250 pages about Stenner attacking him. Now, Marx, of course, endorsed communism, where Stenner was a philosopher who believed in absolute individualism.
Right.
The only thing that matters is me. Mm-hmm. Me, me, me. And if you read this book, it is actually really simple to read, and it's crazy. It is, first of all, I recommend it highly. It's very easy to read, very simple, because all he does is he just talks about how he is really the center of the world. And that's one of the reasons I mentioned him explicitly a few times, Stenner, in the novel, because that is Barrow's favorite philosopher. Who else would it be?
Right.
I believe, I might be wrong about this, and I apologize to my erudite listeners if I'm wrong about this, but I think that Stenner invented the word egoism.
Wow.
So anyway, this is a passage, again, with which I do not agree. Simply because murder is illegal, in quotations, this does not mean that it is, quote, immoral, unquote. What is allowed by the state has nothing to do with questions of right and wrong. What is right or wrong is determined by me. That which pleases me is right. That which does not please me is wrong. I do whatever pleases me, and if it pleases me to kill, then I will kill. Watch out. Now, if try to imagine using Kant's universalization, try to imagine a society that's built on that principle.
Right.
It would be chaos. And first of all, we would be lost. You and I wouldn't even be sitting here today,
right,
if our society 100 years ago or even earlier were built on this principle or followed this principle. It would lead to utter madness. We have to remember that the other person is untouchable. You don't touch the other person. But then again, consider this. Jonathan Barrows, in part one, doesn't touch anyone. He doesn't kill anyone. And in part two, when it seems as if he's killing people, he's really not. Those are just images that people have of him.
Right.
Those are their hallucinations and their fantasies. That wasn't clear in the 2006 version, but as I'm sure you remember, in the note to the reader, I made it crystal clear. Jonathan Barrows actually is not a murderer, but people assume that he's a murderer because of his bizarreness.
Yeah.
But anyway, but let's get back to the main point. You're interested in the disconnection or the connection between author and poetic figure. So let's talk about that. I love that subject.
Right. Yeah, I think that one of the reasons why that passage really jumped out to me is at that point, I mean, it's on page 112. So
yes,
you have spent a considerable amount of time at that point with this character, Jonathan Barrows, in this character's head. And what's disturbing, I think, is by the time you get to that point, you're almost won over by his philosophy. And as you said, this is a crazy philosophy. It is insane, but it is not unimaginable,
which is
I think, something that's paramount to good satire, is that it's just ridiculous enough to where it's not unimaginable.
Yes, it's a wonderful definition of satire. Not necessarily a definition of satire, but a wonderful description of satire, or one of the qualities of satire. I actually like that a lot. Let me say this. Yes, and that is intentional. I managed to seduce most of my readers for about 111 pages to the point at which they think, you know what? I kind of can relate to him. I mean, he's weird, but I can kind of relate to him. That's intentional. And I actually believe, and this is where I sometimes get into trouble, but I do believe this, that every human being has the desire to become God.
Yeah.
I believe every human being has the desire to become, that is to say, free of desire, free of any dependencies to other people, to other things, free of any kind of chains. We all desire, basically what I'm saying is we desire freedom, and the only being who is truly free is God. So we have that desire, and I'm convinced of this. It'd take a great deal to persuade me or to otherwise or to dissuade me.